The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
How good it is to have each and every one of you here today as we celebrate this holiday of Labor Day and are reminded of the gift that the Lord gives us to take and serve Him with gladness in all that we do, all that we say, and where we go. Our order of service this morning is Divine Setting 3. And we likewise welcome those of you that are joining us from home or wherever you may be, and invite you to download the order of service. It's found right there at the link by your picture. And let's begin by singing our opening hymn, hymn number 696, O God, My Faithful God.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave me my sins.
O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter, suffering, and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinner.
And upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Make me understand the way of your precepts, and I will meditate on your wondrous works. Put false ways far from me, and graciously teach me your law.
I have chosen the way of faithfulness, and set your paths and ways before me.
I cling to your testimonies, O Lord. Let me not be put to shame.
I will run.
Make me understand the way of your precepts, and I will meditate on your wondrous works. Glory be to God on high.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O merciful Lord, you did not spare your only Son, but delivered him up for us all. Grant us courage and strength to take up the cross and follow him, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated.
The Old Testament reading for the 13th week of Pentecost is from the book of Deuteronomy, the 30th chapter. See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you today, by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, and by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, then you shall live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to take possession of it. But if your heart turns away, and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are going over the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore, choose life, that you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him. For he is your life and length of days, that you may dwell in the land that the Lord your God swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them. This is the word of the Lord. Fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him lack nothing. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all.
The epistle is from the letter of Philemon, verses 1 through 21. Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother. To Philemon, our beloved fellow worker, and Apria, and our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of the love that you have toward the Lord Jesus and all the saints. And I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. For I have derived much joy and comfort from your love, my brother, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you. Accordingly, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do what is required, yet for love's sake I prefer to appeal to you. I, Paul, an old man and now a prisoner also for Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my children, Onesimus.
whose father I became in my imprisonment. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful to you and to me. I am sending him back to you, sending my very heart. I would have been glad to keep him with me, in order that he might serve me on your behalf during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I preferred to do nothing without your consent, in order that your goodness might not be by compulsion, but of your own free will. For this perhaps is why he has parted from you for a while, that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, as a beloved brother, especially to me. But how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, receive him as you receive me. If he has wronged you at all, or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it, to say nothing of your owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, I want some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Gospel according to St. Luke, the 14th chapter. Now great crowds accompanied Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, desiring to build a tower, does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, 'This man began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to encounter another king in war, will not sit down first and deliberate whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? And if not, while the other is yet a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. So, therefore, any one of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is of no use either for the soil or for the manure pile. It is thrown away. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. This is the gospel of the Lord. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The text for our meditation this morning, today's Old Testament from Deuteronomy 30, in the name of Jesus. Amen. It was a seminal moment in the life of the children of Israel. After 400 years of bondage in Egypt and 40 more years in the desert, they had finally come to the brink of receiving what God had given to their ancestor Abraham as an inheritance. As they stood on the plains of Moab, poised to enter the promised land, Moses had some things to say to them. He would not be going in with them as a result of the events at Meribah, but God had instructed him to set his law before them once again, to review the covenant of life that he had made with his people. Having done this, he leaves them with a challenge. Remain in the covenant and retain the blessings God has given you, or throw it all away. To assist them in their decision, he reminds them of what their choice will mean for them, how it will impact their lives and the lives of their posterity. These are, after all, not trivial choices, are they? Life, good, blessing, death, evil, curse. How you choose between them matters a great deal, for they are polar opposites. Life versus death, good versus evil, blessing or curse. And the consequences of choosing between them are profound. You see, they all go together. He who chooses good chooses blessing and life. He who chooses evil chooses a curse and death. Why are they so interconnected? Because that's how God designed them. You know, when God established the Ten Commandments, he didn't blindly throw darts at a wall. He knew what kind of behavior would lead to a better life. So choosing good, choosing to follow God's design, leads a person on a path to blessing and life. Choosing evil, choosing to live contrary to God's design, leads to curses and death. You will never see a person who makes that practice of choosing evil become a recipient of blessing and life. Oh, there may be those for whom the consequences are delayed. But unless a change in direction occurs, the logical end of our choices will be borne out. If you spend your time and energy looking for a fight, don't be surprised when you find one. If you go around punching people in the nose, someone's eventually going to punch you back. It's just the way it is. As Jesus said, all who takes the sword will perish by the sword. Notice, if you will, that there are only two choices. There's good and evil, life and death, blessing and curse. There's nothing in between. Oh, how we love to create gray areas, but they don't really exist, do they? They're a figment of our imagination. What would you put between good and evil? Good-ish? Bad-ish? Is there really such a thing as being half dead? Maybe to human eyes and intellects, but not to God. In God's eyes, a thing is good or it's evil. In God's eyes, there's either a blessing or a curse. In God's eyes, we're either alive or dead. There's nothing in between. Why? Because these are not merely empty choices. They're two ways of living based on the distinct dichotomies of truth and falsehood, reality and fantasy. Truth is real. Falsehood is fake. There's no middle ground between them. Half-truths are really lies in disguise. Truth and falsehood, like good and evil, are polar opposites. There's a philosophy in our world today that such things are really two sides of the same coin. Absolutely not. Truth and falsehood are sons of different fathers. The father of truth is God. Whatever God says is true. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus prayed to his father, for his disciples. He said, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. Conversely, he said of the devil, when he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. So God is the father of truth, and therefore good, blessing, and life. And the devil is the father of falsehood, and therefore evil, curse, and death. There's no blending of these two ways. There can be no compromise between them. They come from completely different sources and have completely different destinations. We read in the New Testament that our options are really between Christ and his salvation by grace through faith and false religion, which turns us away from Christ and teaches us that we must save ourselves through our own good works. What does Jesus himself say about this? I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. The Apostle Peter says in Acts 4, there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. And he asked Jesus in John 6, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. So when Moses appeals to the people to choose life, he's really saying, choose God. Choose life, he says, that you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him. Sounds good, right? Makes sense? I mean, who wouldn't want to choose life over death, good over evil, blessing over curse? But there's a problem. In our natural state, being sinners by nature, we can't choose life because we don't have the power within ourselves to do it. Without the grace, help, and activity of the Holy Spirit, human beings are not capable of making themselves acceptable to God, of fearing God, or believing in God with their whole heart, or of ridding themselves of the inborn evil lusts in their hearts. This can be accomplished only by the Holy Spirit, who is given through the Word of God. As Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 2, natural man does not receive the gifts of the Spirit of God. Unbelievers cannot choose life. They're dead. Blind, dead, enemies of God. How then could Moses call upon the children of Israel to choose life, to choose God? Because God had chosen them first. We see this throughout the book of Deuteronomy. He loved your fathers and chose their offspring after them and brought you out of Egypt with his own presence by his great power. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for his treasured possession. Out of all the peoples who are on the face of the earth, the Lord set his love on you and chose you. It's the same for us as it was for them. Jesus said, you did not choose me, but I chose you. And John would later write, we love because he first loved us. In response, those who have been chosen and who already have the gift of faith from God have the ability by the power of the Holy Spirit to choose to keep the life that God has given them by grace, or to throw it away and go back to being blind, dead enemies of God. I was raised on a steady diet of being told what I had to do to be a Christian. I had to ask Jesus into my heart. I could never express negative thoughts or feelings. I was only allowed to say nice things to people, even if they were being mean to me. Basically, I had to be a good boy. If I wasn't, my salvation was questioned. I felt compelled for a long time to go to the altar every Sunday and ask Jesus into my heart again, because I struggled with doing and saying all the right things. Beloved, if that in any way describes you, I want you to know that your salvation isn't up to you. You didn't die and rise again to pay for your sins. Jesus did. He is your life and length of days. Indeed, his life was cut short so that yours could be lengthened. Not only will he keep you in his care for your time in this world, he will lengthen your days beyond this world. Through faith in him, through faith in his death and resurrection on your behalf, the promised land of heaven is yours. One day you will cross that river from this world into the next. Then he who is the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep, through whom we have the resurrection of the dead, he who is the very light of heavenly glory, will be waiting there to welcome you with open arms. And you will see in those outstretched hands the very marks by which he earned your place in heaven. Moses told the children of Israel, "Love the Lord your God, obey his voice, and hold fast to him. He is your life and length of days." I say the same to you. Love the Lord your God, obey his voice, and hold fast to him, for he is your life and length of days. He has already saved you, beloved. You are his. He has chosen you. Now choose him. Choose life, for he is your life, and he has already given you life everlasting. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please remain standing. The offering plates will now be brought forward as we continue by singing the offertory. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. O God, our King, you counted the terrible cost of our salvation and sent your Son to give his life on the cross. Inspire our hearts to trust fully in his sacrificial victory, that we would follow in his way through death into eternal life. Lord, in your mercy. Divine Shepherd, you give life to your church through your holy word. Grant your people always to walk in your way and receive your blessings as they serve you in this world and in the life to come. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, you are our life and length of days, and you set before us your gift of life in your holy word. Preserve your institutions of marriage and family. Guard husbands and wives, parents and children, both from despising and from idolizing one another. Instead, let every relationship in the home exemplify your unconditional love for us in Christ, and grant that all might follow him in their service to one another. Lord, in your mercy. Good Lord, preserve us from the ways of the wicked and prosper us in your path. We commend to you all who bear office in our land and ask you to make them a blessing to those they serve. Grant to us every joy in calling you, in the calling you have given to us, that we might render service to you in our works of love toward our neighbor. Remember those in need of honest labor and daily bread, and give them gainful employment according to your good and gracious will. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, give the strength of the Spirit to all who are suffering or in any kind of need, and especially to those who we have been asked to remember, including Kathy, Diane, Frank, Dennis and Judy, Sam and Amy, Shirley, Lorena, Dan, the Melodic family, Kurt, Heather, Joanne, Jean, Wayne, Lana, George, Tim, Sandy, Juliet, Scott, Norb, Brenda, Judy, Lynn, Janet, Dominic, Mary, Matt, Rick, Bud, Betsy, David, Lisa, Cindy, Ray, Laverne, Michael, Carla, Peter, Dorothy, Karen, Liz, Shannon, Ronald, Joyce, Ronald, Joan, Michael, Merle, Jeff, Donna, and all whom we lift before you in our hearts. May they all have the courage and will to take up their crosses and follow the Savior through suffering into the joys of life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed Father, we praise you together with those celebrating special events this week, including those with birthdays: Ethan, Eric, Brittany, Alexa, Eileen, Catherine, Cora, Rodney, Karen and Kathy, and those with wedding anniversaries: Tom and Barbara, Dan and Peggy, Tammy and Michael, Tim and Janine, and Eric and Brittany. Lord, in your mercy. Grant your continued aid and support, O Lord, to the Lutherans in Jewish evangelism ministry as they endeavor to reach out with the love of Christ to your original people. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you have set before us life and death, blessing and curse in your holy word. Now at the altar, through his own word, your Son sets before us his own body and blood. Grant that all who receive the sacrament today might do so with prepared and penitent hearts, rejoicing in your gifts of forgiveness, life, and salvation for Jesus' sake. Lord, in your mercy. Preserve us, O Lord, from all temptation, and grant us faith, that we may rest all our prayers and the desires of our hearts in your merciful arms. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the one true faith, the life everlasting. Depart in peace.
Amen.
Give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Let us pray. We give thanks unto you, Almighty God, that you refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
Bless we the Lord.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Pastor, any matters of importance from you?
Just one quick announcement, and that is a reminder that we are still in need of one additional teacher's aide for our 4K program. So if you're at all interested in helping with that, please speak to me so that we might be able to arrange something for that.
Thank you. And one final thing. We're making preparations, as you may have seen, for the annual craft fair. Information is posted around in different places. Sally Bolin is directing that, and she's in the back today. If you have any questions, please talk to Sally. Let's sing our closing hymn. God's blessings on your weekend.